Hey guys, Lucas here. Today, I want to discuss spirituality in art. Specifically, what art forms seem to be the most universally assigned to spiritual experience, as well as what techniques in these forms are the most powerful. It's important to lay out exactly what I mean by spirituality. Most people would describe it as a certain universal wholeness, the feeling of all things being interconnected and combined. I think this is a fine interpretation. However, I think we can get a little more specific. To me, I think someone obtains spirituality when they perceive a pattern on the highest possible level. Spirituality can be seen as the highest form of pattern recognition, bearing witness to the patterns that span all of reality. So art forms that rely on patterns, I believe, are the most capable of creating a spiritual experience. This is made more apparent when looking at music. Music being the most revered art, used often with religious connotations to evoke the spirit. Some even say that music is the art form that is the most representative of reality, since it is the purest way to portray patterns. Classical music relies solely on portraying changing patterns in pitch and across time. The changes across time seem to be the most powerful. So the temporal forms generate spirituality by changing patterns across time. But what are the other art forms, such as painting, sculpture, and architecture? The main difference between these two types of art is how we bear witness to them. In a temporal work, we shut everything else out. In a film or live performance, we shut off all the lights and hone in on the work alone. Music is no different. We listen solely to the music and cut everything else out. These works exist in a different time, in a mythic time. The other art forms do not have this quality. The change in patterns to evoke the spirit in something like architecture is generated by how it changes from its surroundings, or how it imitates its surroundings. In the book, The Sacred and the Profane by Mircea Eliade, he discusses the spiritual connotations of architecture. He lays out many examples, one being the Christian cathedral, claiming the four parts of the interior of the church symbolize the four cardinal directions. The interior of the church is the universe. The altar is paradise, which lays in the east. The west, on the contrary, is the realm of darkness, of grief, of death, the realm of eternal mansions of the dead, who await resurrection of the flesh in the last judgment. The middle of the building is the earth. This copy of the cosmos incarnates and sanctifies the world. It brings the macrocosm to the microcosm and rejuvenates it. As human beings recreate the works of the gods, they become the contemporaries of the gods. Paintings and sculptures are presented within an environment of several other paintings and sculptures. The act of curating and displaying these works is an art in and of itself. The way the paintings change across the room and how they contrast with the world at large is how they evoke the spirit. So it seems that there are two forms of art, ones that exist in mythic time and ones that exist within a more material time. I believe the mythic time works are genuinely timeless. A good story or film or song can still be enjoyed today, and more importantly, can be enjoyed the same way it was experienced when it was first created. However, I'm not sure if the same can be said about the works that exist in material time, since they rely so heavily on contrasting against the environment. Once the environment changes, which seems to change faster and faster every day, the harder it is to experience the work in its original way. There are obvious exceptions, but I do believe, generally speaking, the works that exist in their own time can preserve far longer than material works. Even the oldest work in material time that is experienced to this day is the Nap of Hawar, which is the oldest building in the world. And even then, it is seen completely differently from how it was seen when it was first made almost 5,000 years ago. Whereas, there are fairy tales that are dated to have been relatively unchanged from 10,000 years ago to now. While both types of art forms are beautiful and I'm grateful we have both, I do believe the works that exist in mythic time reveal the spiritual more naturally, mainly because the material works rely on changes and affinities in 3D space, whereas the mythic works rely on changes in 4D space, and I suspect we are far more sensitive to the latter. Why are we so sensitive to art that exists temporally? I've always felt that human beings might be the first fourth dimensional life forms. The lion cares about changes on the horizon and in his environment. A slight change in color could indicate a new meal. While human beings also have this ability, we go above and beyond and take great interest in how things change across time. Not only that, but human beings require change across time. Other animals can find enjoyment in a purely 3D space. We can give dogs all the food they want and a space to run freely in, and they'll be happy. However, it's been debated for centuries if human beings could ever enjoy such a paradise. If we could ever accept such a situation. We need progression. It's from this that we derive such meaning from the temporal forms, for it's a dimension we are the most sensitive to. So what are the patterns that can be made across time that create a spiritual response? This is a very difficult thing to discuss, so I think it's better to discuss examples. A great spiritual film in recent years is Tree of Life. This one was interesting because it shows that not all people see the spiritual in all the same works. It's very subjective. I saw a lot of people discussing Tree of Life as a nihilistic work. I'm assuming they thought this because the film counterpoints the story of a Texan family going through hardships with shots of the birth and death of the universe, suggesting that the story of the Texan family is meaningless in the grand scheme of things. However, I feel this couldn't be further from the truth. The Tree of Life is a Hermetic term, which one of the most prominent sayings of Hermetic philosophy is, as above, as below. The heavens are here on earth because the rules of heaven dictate the rules of the earth. When we see the birth of life and its death in this Texan family, and it's counterpointed by the universe being born, it's not suggesting that the family drama is meaningless. It's saying that the universe follows the same rules as this family. They are of the same work. They are contemporaries. As for specifics, there's a few techniques that I believe can be used to elicit the sense of the spirit. These techniques aren't used purely for the spiritual. They have a plethora of uses. It's just that one of those uses is to reveal the sacred. In film, I think the technique with the most power in this regard is the zoom in and the zoom out. The reasoning can be found back in the book, The Sacred and the Profane, when the claim is made that the material exists in the profane. It is a heterogeneous and chaotic mess, seemingly impossible to make any sense out of. This heterogeneous environment is transformed when human beings discover the sacred, whether it is a tree, rock, or otherwise. That now acts as the sacred piece of their tribe. It is the center of the world, the homogeneous beginning from which all other things sprout out from. This isn't to say that the rock or tree created the universe in a scientific and historical way, but in a mythical way. I believe the zoom in and zoom out can show this quite beautifully. When you start in a close-up and zoom out, you begin with the homogeneous and whole subject. And as we zoom out and more of the heterogeneous environment enters our visual field, we see it as the heterogeneous environment as springing up and being created out of the beginning original subject. The zoom in is obviously just the reverse of that. We start with the heterogeneous chaos of the environment and we zoom in to discover what lies in the center of the world. Now, I don't believe physically moving the camera would create the same effect. The movement through 3D space is a profane phenomena, so it'd be difficult to create a spiritual moment or suggest something is sacred when you are using a profane and material technique, one that exists in the everyday of our normal world. The zoom lies completely outside of human experience, which increases its effect on film. Now, I'm not saying that a spiritual film needs to only use spiritual techniques. Film is about juxtaposition. So intercutting profane techniques and sacred techniques would only make the sacred more powerful. When it comes to paintings, Gustav Klimt would use a 1:1 aspect ratio for his landscape paintings, claiming that he felt the ratio helped create the sense of universal oneness, a feeling of utter completeness. In Wassily Kandinsky's book, Concerning the Spiritual in Art, he said that the color blue is the most heavenly of all the colors, which seems like a reasonable claim. It is the color that always lies the highest in our visual field. As for music, I'm unfortunately not nearly as educated on that as I am in other forms, so I can't say much. However, there is one interesting album that I'd like to discuss. Around a year ago, I picked up the vinyl Akira Symphonic Suite by Ginon Yashirogumi. For those who don't know, it is a very high-quality remaster to vinyl of the Akira soundtrack. This vinyl came with a very detailed booklet about the making of the music. One of the most interesting things was the use of very high frequencies to produce bizarre effects, this being coined the hypersonic effect. These were unable to be fully produced in previous releases on CD, since CD can't produce sound above 22.05 kHz. This newest vinyl release was the first time they were fully incorporated with the album. This hypersonic effect, which isn't even audible to human ears, produces several psychological and physiological effects. Listeners would perceive the sound with a sense of beauty, pleasure, and sensation. A more specific example of one of the effects this produces is that as somebody listens to the soundtrack, they will turn up the music more and more and more until it's playing at 11. I found myself subject to this phenomenon before I read the booklet. I was hardly even aware of it, but once I read that section, it was clear that I had been affected by these ultra-high frequencies. One less interesting detail about this album is that Yaoshi Ogumi was actually inspired by a paradigm of Mugen no, meaning no of dreams and illusion in English, which caused him to see matters from the perspective of the dead. That's pretty much all I want to discuss about that. I'm interested in what you guys think down below. Let me know what works of art you believe are the most spiritual and have affected you the most. Also, I'd like to thank you all for helping this channel get to 300 subscribers. It really means a lot to me. Thanks for watching, and I hope you have a great rest of your day.